Hey, what's up, everybody? We are back. All right, so we just finished up the last study, so we're going to jump right into this one. For those of you in the room, if you can hear me, press one before we get started. Press one, and that way I can make sure you guys hear me before I get started. So I've been waiting to do this study for a while. I've touched on the 400 years several times before, and I wanted to come back to it because it's, you know, we're always learning and stuff. So press the one if you can hear me. I'll wait till I see some ones. There we go. I see some ones. All right, moderators, be on your job, please. If anybody wants to come in here teaching their crazy doctrine, just time them out. This ain't the place for it. If they want to do that, they can do it on their own channel. If they want to teach that salvation is for Israel only, time them out. If they want to come in here teaching that Gentiles are the northern kingdom, if they haven't shown the proof on their own channel, time them out, because none of that is going to be tolerated. They can do that in their own time on their own channel. So yeah, just stay on your job, moderators. Don't let anybody come in disrupting. If you guys want to support, you could do so at patreon.com/DanteFortson. The PayPal link is on the main YouTube page. And you can support via Cash App, #BHITB, or the Super Chat. The Super Chat by clicking the dollar sign or the S in the chat. All right, so now we're going to talk about the Gentiles, the 400 years. We're going to talk about a list of things. And I'm going to, let me see here. Yeah, we're just going to fill in some blanks. Some stuff I've touched on, so you guys will have heard it before. Some stuff I have not touched on before. So it'll be, may not be new to you in general, just be new stuff I've talked about on the channel. So I'm going to give it a second. Let some more of you guys get in here. Make sure you hit that thumbs up button. Make sure you share this. This should get interesting. I might take some questions during this one at the end. So if you have questions in the chat, save your questions until the end, and then I'll get to them. I'll probably do, I don't know. We'll just see how the Q&A goes at the end. So again, save your questions. Don't come in being disruptive. Don't come in trying to teach your doctrine. Feel free to time them out if they're doing that. All right, so now let's talk about the 400 years. There's been a whole lot of conversation about the 400 years. What does it mean? How is it interpreted? And we know that a lot of the confusion is intentionally caused by the urban apologists because they don't operate on behalf of God. They are trying to operate against God. And so they're looking for any occasion where they can go against God and go against anything that makes it easy to understand what's going on. They are stuck in their Eurocentric Christian doctrine, and that's what they're trying to defend, which we know is opposed to the ways of the Most High, which is why many of us left that setting to begin with. We're gonna clear some of this confusion up caused by them. And recently they've tried to start a whole new set of confusion, but we'll get to that. All right, so we got people in the chat. Cool, we got 228 people here. Let's go ahead and get started. Make sure you click the thumbs up. Make sure you share this, please. All right, and make sure, let me go ahead and give me a second here. All right. And if you have not grabbed your copy of Undeniable yet, please do so. There's the link. I'm dropping the link in the chat so you guys can grab that whenever you, if you haven't read it already. So now I'm going to start this with Ecclesiastes 1, 9 through 10, because I think this is important to understand. And give me a second to pull it up. I think I spelled that right. Oh, yep, I did. Okay. Ecclesiastes 1, 9 through 10. We're going to kick it off with that. Let me share my screen. Make sure you guys hit that thumbs up and subscribe if you are not already subscribed. All right, 9 through 10. It says, "The thing that hath been is that which shall be, and that which is done is that which shall be done, and there is no new thing under the sun. Is there anything whereof it may be said, see, this is new? It hath been already of old time, which was before us. Or another way of saying that would be history repeats itself. I guess a simple way of saying that history repeats itself. And so we can look to past events in order to find patterns or prophecies or predictions that point towards future events. And this is not widely taught in a lot of churches because they already have their theology that they are given when they go to seminary, which are usually the seminary is usually European owned and controlled. And so they teach that doctrine out of those seminaries. And so they defend a doctrine. All right. So again, make sure you hit those thumbs up. So history repeats itself. So now some people will say, well, you can't apply the 400-year captivity to the transatlantic slave trade because the it already happened in the book of Exodus. But then they will also admit that in the book of Exodus, there are problems with the text because the time doesn't add up. We know that they walked in voluntarily. We know that they weren't in captivity the whole 430 years. And then we start to do more digging. We see in the Septuagint that is 430 between Canaan and Egypt, and it ends up dividing into 215 in each part. So we know that there's a problem with the text. All right, you guys can still hear me? Okay, cool. All right, just want to make sure you guys hear me still. Somebody posted loud and clear. That's why I asked. Okay. So yeah, there are problems with that text, which is why we say, okay, the 400 years must point to something else. So we're going to break down that 400 years, and we're going to talk real briefly about why they're trying to bring up the Amorites as an opposition to the 400-year prophecy. Because, well, let me just go to Genesis. Let me pull up Genesis real quick. 15, and we're going to read verses 13, and we're going to start at verse 13. So let me share my screen. All right, cool. I see the ones. All right. So, yeah, we're going to talk about some of this stuff. I'm not going to touch on every single thing to do with this. And again, if you have questions, please save your questions to the end. Moderators, please be on your job. Thank you. All right, here we go. Genesis, we're going to start Genesis 15 and 13, and we're going to read some. Oh, wait, I don't know why. All right, here we go. Genesis 15, started verse 13, and we'll read a little bit. And he said unto Abram, you know what, let me back up. So it says, and when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and lo, a horror of great darkness fell upon him. And he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. Now, here, some people take this out of context and they say, well, they're going to be enslaved for 400 years, which we know that, yes, yeah, slavery never ended here in the United States. Some people have found a way to justify slavery. Mm-hmm. But the part of the curse was slavery and affliction or oppression. And so this was going to last 400 years. Now, we know that the White House recognizes 400 years. I've gone over it with the Wall Street Journal, recognizing the 400 years. Matter of fact, let me give you guys this link right here. If you have not watched the Deuteronomy study, the Deuteronomy 28 study, I'm posting the link in the chat real quick so you guys can watch that later. So now, they will be enslaved and oppressed for 400 years. Those that are familiar with Black history in America specifically, they know that we were brought here and enslaved. And then after slavery supposedly ended, a lot of slave owners did not tell the slaves that slavery was over. And then when slavery was over, the plantations were replaced with prisons. The slave patrols were replaced with police. Slaves no longer had to have their permission slips to leave the plantation. They had to have their license and registration when they were driving around. They had to have their identification. So a lot of this stuff is just an extension of the old system. And it got updated basically as time went on. Now, we know that laws were created intentionally to target people of our skin color. And the reason I say it that way is because sometimes, every now and then, you know, people of other descent who have the same skin color as us get mistaken for us. So laws were intentionally created to oppress us. And, you know, some people got caught up in those as kind of collateral damage. But vagrancy laws is one example of that. Make sure y'all hit that thumbs up, please. Vagrancy laws is an example of that. They knew people who were former slaves had no money and nowhere to go. So they wrote laws that would make them criminals when before they weren't criminals. So before, it was not a crime to not have anything. And so they made it a crime to not have anything because they knew that these people who had just been free from slavery had nothing, and they could put them back in slavery and say, look, they were breaking the law. We wrote a law and we wrote it based on them. So now they're breaking the law by having nothing. So we went from the slave codes to the black codes. We had Jim Crow. And now we know we have the 94 crime bill. I mean, there's all kind of history of oppression of our people in this country. And we know it's been for 400 years because the important part is Congress acknowledges it. The UN acknowledges it. Pretty much most people on the planet acknowledge that 1619 is where most people start that date from. So now, once again, and he said unto Abram, know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterward they shall come out with great substance. Now, I'm going to stop right there for a second. There's an order of events here. Unfortunately, those that like lying, they will not give you the order of events. So they tried to run this scenario and say, well, the 400 year prophecy failed. No, the 400 year prophecy did not fail. What did it say would happen for 400 years? Know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years. So the 400 year affliction and servitude, and it says also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge. So there has to be a judgment. The 400 years, then they will be judged, and afterward they shall come out with great substance. There's an order of events there. And I talked about this in my final Juneteenth article on blackhistorythebible.com. We don't know how long the judgment lasts. We see in Egypt, when they were in Egypt, they were in the land while judgment was happening. Now, for those that believe that slavery of Israelites started before 1619, understand, they grouped everybody together as just African or Hamite because that is their teaching. This is the doctrine they want to defend so badly. And so what they'll do is they'll take any black person and say, well, look, these black people here were in slavery, so therefore the slavery started before. And that's not necessarily the case. So 1619 is recognized. Now, the Most High gives us an easy time clock to follow. And there's a reason that 400 years is significant in being talked about, because it falls into the biblical timeline, even though people don't want to admit. And there's a series of events that point to the fact that, hey, this is that captivity and not any other one. And if you say it's any other one, you have to show me an exact 400 year period that gets acknowledged in history, along with all of the other signs that I'm going to show you guys today. So we got 467 people in here. Please go ahead and hit that thumbs up for me, please. All right, now. So also the nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterward they shall come out with great substance. So the judgment is going to happen, and then Israel is going to come out with great substance. I think it's interesting that right now, after the 400-year period that ended, there is judgment happening. We see people dropping dead everywhere, lockdowns, food shortages, famines in other parts of the world, natural disasters. People can pretend like nothing is going on all they want to, but the fact is people are dropping dead. Whether you believe COVID is a virus or a biological weapon, it doesn't matter what it is. That's the irrelevant part. What it is the irrelevant part. What's relevant is that after the 400 years ended, we went on lockdown. people started dropping dead. Famine started happening. Locust swarms were happening. I mean, monkey swarms, all kind of stuff was happening. People getting locked up in buildings. It was crazy. We saw the video, the footage coming out of China, I believe it was, out of Wuhan. And we saw how the reaction was going there. And we see other stuff, the earthquakes that happened. We had that series of earthquakes, one of which made the trumpet that the angel Moroni was holding in Utah fall out of its hand or out of his hand. And so we see all of this stuff happening. And some people are saying, well, there's no big deal. At the same time this is happening, the awakening is happening. And as Teo pointed out, the falling away is happening at the same time that the awakening is happening. So there's lots of stuff. And we're going to cover some of this using scripture. So let's go to, let's see. Oh, you know what? Before I go there, let's just finish this. I don't want to have to come back to it. So now they try to tie this to the Amorites. They try to tie this to the Amorites, and they'll say, well, what about the Amorites? Now, notice what the Bible does. The Bible, if we believe it's inspired by God, it means none of the breaks that occur between certain things are by accident. It means that we're getting a break for a reason. So now it says they shall come out with great substance. And then it switches back to Abraham, and thou shalt go to thy fathers in peace. Thou shalt be buried in a good old age. Now it comes back and says, but in the fourth generation, they shall come hither again, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. So is this all one single prophecy, or is this two separate prophecies, which is why we see a sudden transition? Why not just tell Abraham this after he says this part right here? There's a reason. It seems to be that there is a break intended there. So the Amorite prophecy is not necessarily connected to the 400 years, even though some people will say that. But again, the break could have occurred. They could have easily said this after, kept these two together as one thought, and then that would have been problem solved. But he didn't. It interrupts, and he tells Abraham something. He says, and thou shall go to thy fathers in peace. Thou shall be buried in a good old age. But in the fourth generation, they shall come hither again, for the iniquity of the Amorites is not yet full. So context will give you a lot of key to the interpretation. Make sure you guys hit that like button, please. 514 people in here. Shout out to everybody that's new as well. Please feel free to make yourself at home. Just respect the rules of the house. All right. So now in the book of Jeremiah. So here's why it's important to understand context. They will tell you that this happened already, so it can't possibly apply to us. Now, this part right here is important. Know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs. The land that is not theirs. So they were in Canaan. If we read the Bible, part of the land from the great river Nile over to the river Euphrates, I believe, which covers part of Africa, the Arabian Peninsula, and a little bit of that section over there, heading into Asia. That is given to them in scripture. So the land that is not theirs can't be the part of Egypt they were in, can't be Canaan. It can't be any of that area over there. And I believe the Euphrates includes, all the way to the Euphrates, that will include part of ancient Babylon. So they're going to be in a land, a stranger in a land that is not theirs, not given to them by God. And there's some other signs that point to this captivity being the one referred to in the Bible. So let's go to Jeremiah chapter 9, 15 through 16, because if this captivity had already happened, we have to figure out what Jeremiah is referring to, because Jeremiah refers to something that I find to be very interesting. We're going to go to chapter 9, verses 15 and 16. Let me see. Let me make sure I got the right verses here. All right, here we go. Yeah, we're going to start at verse 13 and go through 16. And the Lord saith, because they have forsaken my law, which I set before them, and have not obeyed my voice, neither walk therein, but have walked after the imagination of their own heart and after Balaam, which their fathers taught them. Therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will feed them, even this people, with wormwood and give them water of gall to drink. I will scatter them also among the heathen, whom neither they nor their fathers have known, and I will send a sword after them until I've consumed them. So if they were already, if this was already fulfilled in Egypt, what is Jeremiah talking about when the Lord says, I will scatter them also among the heathen, whom neither they nor their fathers have known? We see this language is similar to exactly what was being said in the book of Genesis. So we know that there is something coming, and we're going to see this passed down, I guess you would call it, throughout the Bible until we get to Christ, when he says they shall be led captive into all nations. So there's something coming. We see it in Genesis. It's a 400 year period coming in a land that is not their own. We see this here in Jeremiah. Sow them among the heathen whom neither their fathers, they nor their fathers have known. Let's go to Jeremiah 16. We're going to read verses 9 through 15. All right, Jeremiah 16. We'll start at verse 9. For thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will cause to cease out of this place in your eyes and in your days the voice of mirth and the voice of gladness and the voice of the bridegroom and the voice of the bride. And it shall come to pass, when thou shalt show this people all these words, they shall say unto thee, wherefore hath the Lord pronounced all this great evil against us? Or why has God done this to us? And many of us have talked about that. Why is all this stuff happening to us specifically and no other people on the earth? Or what is our iniquity? Or what is our sin that we have committed against the Lord our God? Then shall thou say unto them, because your fathers have forsaken me, saith the Lord, and have walked after other gods and have served them and have worshiped them and have forsaken me and have not kept my law. Which I find to be interesting. Now, if Satan deceived the whole world, let's talk about spiritual warfare here, end game, stuff like that. If Satan doesn't want to be destroyed in the lake of fire, there are multiple levels of spiritual warfare that he would try to pull off in order to keep that from happening. Hiding our identity, erasing our identity, putting us in a mainstream belief system that teaches us that we have the liberty in Christ to break the law. All these teachings seem like they are meant to keep Israel from waking up, turning back to God, doing the right thing, and setting everything in motion. So it says, we would ask, why is this happening? And his answer is, because your fathers have forsaken me. Now, some people in the church will say, well, I have a problem with God punishing the son for the iniquities of the fathers. But we know if a 400 year sentence is pronounced on Israel, nobody's living to be 400 years old right now. So, and even when you get to the Exodus, nobody in Exodus was living to be 400 years old right then either. So it would mean that the curse, a 400 year curse, would by default pass to the fathers, the grandfathers, the grandchildren, the sons, all of those people over a 400 year period. And it says, ye have done worse than your fathers, for behold, ye walk everyone after the imaginations of his evil heart, that he may not hearken unto me. So they come up with excuses to not listen to him. This is why I point out that some people under the Eurocentric Christian belief will always use that term Judaizers or being legalistic, or they have the liberty in Christ to do whatever they want to. So they have excuses not to listen. Therefore, will I cast you out of this land into a land that ye know not. Sounds exactly like what is being said in the book of Genesis, in a land that they don't know. Already been in Egypt. So where are they going to go into captivity? Fathers, and there shall ye serve other gods day and night, where I will not show you favor. Hold on, let me pull up a map. Give me a second here. All right, let me see here. All right, you guys are saying two. You can't hear me. Am I breaking up? Let me know if I'm breaking up. I got one, some twos. All right, let me know if when you can hear me good. I'm gonna pull up a map. All right, I see ones coming. Give me a second here. I'm trying to find a good world, because they're gonna go to a land that neither them nor their fathers have known. Oh wait, that's not what I wanted to happen at all. Okay, hopefully, let me see if I can enlarge this map and then all right, I'm seeing ones. Perfect. Oh, this has way too many advertisements on it. Let me go back here. All right. I think this map should work. Okay. I guess I'll just use this map because I'm not going to sit here and look for the map the whole time. All right. So right here, there now, it started in Genesis. He says he's going to send them to a land that they don't know. Jeremiah, who's captive in Babylon, is still saying they're going to get sent to a Egyptian captivity wasn't the captivity. The Babylonian captivity happening then is not the captivity being referred to. And so we see here that if we accept the boundaries, we have the Nile River here. They were given the Nile all the way over to the Euphrates. So like all of this likely over here up into here, that was likely all of their land, right? So a land that is not theirs, a land that they don't know. We know that they were familiar with Libya and Cush and all these parts of Africa. We know that they're going to be familiar with all this over here. And then we know that they are going to end up in Europe as well, spreading out into Europe. All right. I see more twos. All right. Give me a second here. Let me make sure I'm not streaming any video. All right. Let me turn that off and that off. Hopefully that takes care of that. Give me a second. Let me close down a few more videos here. And then I didn't realize so many videos are open. Okay, there we go. And one more. All right, cool. All right, so I'll see the ones again. Okay, perfect. So now Jeremiah is still talking about them going into a captivity in a land that is not their own. So we just saw that in Jeremiah chapter 16. We're going to keep going. We got two more verses to read in Jeremiah. But I just want to show you guys that map real quick. So they had already been familiar with that. So let's go to 14 and 15. It says, therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that it shall no more be said, the Lord liveth, that brought up the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. So they're not going to talk about that event anymore. But the Lord liveth that brought up the children of Israel from the land of the north and from all the lands whither they had been driven, whither he had driven them. And I will bring them again into their land that I gave unto their fathers, meaning they weren't in their land. They were going to be driven into a bunch of other lands, and he's going to bring them back. And people aren't going to talk about the exodus from Egypt anymore. They're going to talk about this other exodus. So something else is going on. And the church doesn't explain why this reference keeps coming up to Israel being sent to a land that is not theirs. If it had already been fulfilled, there would be no need for Jeremiah to mention it again. So finally, let's go look at Jeremiah 23. We're going to look at verses 5-8. So right here it says, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will raise unto David a righteous branch, and a king shall reign and prosper and shall execute judgment and justice in the earth. In his days, Judah shall be saved and Israel shall dwell safely. And this is his name whereby he shall be called the Lord of righteousness. Therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that they will no more say, the Lord liveth, which brought up the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, but the Lord liveth, which brought up and which led the seed of the house of Israel out of the north country and from all the countries whither I had driven them, and they shall dwell in their own land. So this event is going to be widely talked about. The 1948 event is not the event. We know this. We know that there was not a mass exodus. There was basically the League of Nations and the British and the Americans going in there slaughtering people and stealing land. It wasn't anything miraculous. It's what they always did. And then they put people there in that land. So the 1948 event is not the event of Scripture. But we see that this event in Scripture is going to be talked about. There's going to be a massive regathering of people. Now, we touched on them being led captive, and I shared the Deuteronomy 28 link already. If you guys have not seen it, go watch the Deuteronomy 28 study on my main channel. So now let's go to Jeremiah 29, since we're here in the book of Jeremiah already. And we're going to go down to verse, 14. All right, let's start at verse 11. Now, again, why I started this study off with history repeats itself, because we can look at the past and see exactly how the present will play, or the future will play out. It says, for I know the thoughts, this is Jeremiah 29, 11. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. Then shall ye call upon me, and ye shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. And ye shall seek me and find me when ye shall search for me with all your heart. And I will be found of you, saith the Lord, and I will turn away your captivity, and I will gather you from all the nations, and from all the places whither I have driven you, saith the Lord, and I will bring you again into the place whence I caused you to be carried away captive. So now we see that he switches to all nations. Remember, if they're in Babylon, why is he talking about gathering them from all nations and finding them, them finding him again? He's going to turn away their captivity, right? So there's going to be this second exodus. We know that Jeremiah is a prophet. He's speaking prophetically. Let me see. I want to make sure I don't skip over anything before I go to Leviticus. All right. Yeah. So he's going to gather them out of all nations, gather Israel out of all nations. This is the rapture event that the church, this is what I believe. I'll say it this way. I believe this is the rapture event that the church likes to preach. I believe it's the regathering of Israel, not of the whole entire Christian church. And I believe those Gentiles that cling with Israel, we'll go with Israel. There will be a mixed multitude, just like the first Exodus, but only if those Gentiles are cleaving unto Israel. And we have some Gentiles that don't want anything to do with Israel. And so they will be very surprised when the rapture event does not go down like they think it goes down. All right. So let's go to Leviticus 26. And we're going to start at verse 27. Now, it's a lot of stuff in Leviticus. I think Leviticus is an often overlooked book when it comes to prophecy and when it comes to other stuff in the Bible, because it's one of the books of the law. And it is honestly gets pretty boring in certain spots. I mean, we all know this. It does get when you're reading lists and stuff like that. But I mean, it's so much stuff in the parts that seem boring once you really start to dig. So Leviticus 26, 27, and if ye will not hearken, I'm sorry, let me back up. If ye will not for all this hearken unto me, but walk contrary unto me, then I will walk contrary unto you also in fury. And I will chastise you seven times for your sins. And ye shall eat the flesh of your sons, and the flesh of your daughters shall ye eat. And I will destroy your high places and cut down your images and cast your carcasses upon the carcasses of your idol, and my soul shall abhor you. Now, last time when I went over the we went over to Deuteronomy 28 curses, I showed you guys the documents that talked about cannibalism during the transatlantic slave trade, and that the people meant for slavery were scared that the Europeans were cannibals and were going to eat them. And then we see stories on board the ships where they were eating them. And in a minute, I'm going to cut to a video Pastor Kelly recently did. After we look at a few more verses, I'm going to cut to that video that Pastor Kelly recently did. And we're going to look at some of that evidence that Pastor Kelly did as well. Hold on real quick. Let me see. All right. Yeah, I do have the video. OK, cool. I just want to make sure I had the video ready to go when I get to it. All right, let me share my screen again. We'll keep reading Leviticus. Let's see. And I will destroy your high places and cut down your images and cast your carcasses upon the carcasses of your idols, and my soul shall abhor you. And I will make your cities waste and bring your sanctuaries unto desolation, and I will not smell the savor of your sweet odors. And I will bring the land into desolation, and your enemies which dwell therein shall be astonished at it. And I will scatter you among the heathen and will draw out a sword after you, and your land shall be desolate and your cities waste. I want to make sure I don't go too far. Okay, 46. Then shall the land enjoy her Sabbaths as long as it lieth desolate, and ye be in your enemy's land. Even then shall the land rest and enjoy her Sabbaths. As long as it lieth desolate, it shall rest, because it did not rest in your Sabbaths when ye dwelt upon it. And upon them that are left alive of you, I will send a faintness into their hearts in the lands of their enemies. And the sound of a shaken leaf shall chase them, and they shall flee as fleeing from a sword, and they shall fall when none pursueth. So we see that they're going to have this fear, right? Always in fear. We see people now, we see the Deuteronomy 28 curses when it says their life shall hang in doubt before them. We know that police are meant to serve and protect, but that's not what they do all the time. We know that there's a chance we could get beat or murdered, and in the case of women, beat, murdered, raped, all kind of stuff. We can be falsely charged with a crime. So we know what that is. And then if you look to the past, we see that the Klan terrorized our people for however long, a century, and they still exist. The Klan has not been eradicated within the borders of the United States. And I find that to be quite telling of the type of people that we are among. All right. And it says, they shall fall one upon another, as it were before a sword, when none pursueth, and ye shall have no power to stand before your enemies. And we know what the situation is here. And ye shall perish among the heathen, and the land of your enemies shall eat you up. And again, I used to think some of this stuff was figurative, but after doing the research about cannibalism in America, going on in early America, and some of what you're going to see Pastor Kelly talk about, you may start to take some of this stuff literally about the land of our enemies eating us up. And they that are left of you shall pine away in their iniquity in your enemies' lands, and also in the iniquities of their fathers shall they pine away with them. If they shall confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers with their trespass, which they trespassed against me, and that also they have walked contrary unto me, and that I also have walked contrary unto them, and have brought them into the land of their enemies, if their uncircumcised hearts be humbled, and they then accept of the punishment of their iniquity, then I will remember my covenant with Jacob, and also my covenant with Isaac, and also my covenant with Abraham will I remember, and I will remember the land. Now, again, they don't want to believe that a punishment could be pronounced upon the father and it passed down to the son and the grandson and so on. But we know that's not true. Now, one of the things for the second coming, or what they refer to as the rapture, I believe it's of Israel, is that we have to confess our iniquity and that we have trespassed and walked contrary to God, and accept the punishment. And then he will remember the covenant. See, they didn't want us to understand that, right? They didn't want us to turn back to God, which is why we were presented with a belief system, Eurocentric Christianity, and it teaches those things. It teaches us excuses to break the laws of God. And then once we start to see there's a problem with that, We usually come into it one of two ways. I started to see the problems with it before I came into the revelation that we were Israel. But once I came into the revelation that we were Israel, it became even more apparent that what we were given was meant to keep us blind. It was meant to keep us as close to the truth as possible without actually being the full truth. And so that's why it's successful in blinding a lot of our people. It says, and the land also shall be left to them and shall enjoy her Sabbaths while she lieth desolate without them. And they shall accept of the punishment of their iniquity because they despise my judgments and because their soul abhorred my statutes. And yet for all that, when they be in the land of their enemies, I will not cast them away, neither will I abhor them to destroy them utterly and to break my covenant with them, for I am the Lord their God. But I will for their sakes remember the covenant of their ancestors, whom I brought forth out of the land of Egypt in the sight of the heathen, that I might be their God. I am the Lord. These are the statutes and judgments and laws which the Lord made between him and the children of Israel in Mount Sinai by the hand of Moses. All right. So we see that there. Let's go to Nehemiah 1 verses 8 through 9 before we get to the Pastor Kelly video. Shout out to Pastor Kelly. He did a great job explaining some of this. And just to give you guys a heads up, it is some graphic stuff, images in the Pastor Kelly video. So if you have children watching this, because I know some of you have expressed that you do let your kids watch, it is images of lynchings. So if you don't want your kids to see those images, or if you don't want to see those images, I will warn you before I start playing the Pastor Kelly video, so you can either look away or you know, turn it away from your kids if you don't want them to see those images. All right, so let's go to Nehemiah chapter, we're there, 1 verses 8 and 9. It says, remember, I beseech thee, the word that thou commandest thy servant Moses, saying, if ye transgress, I will scatter you abroad among the nations. So now he's telling him he's going to scatter them among the nations. But if ye turn unto me and keep my commandments and do them, though there were of you cast out unto the uttermost part of heaven, yet will I gather them from thence and will bring them unto the place that I have chosen to set my name there. So Israel is going to be regathered after they are scattered. Remember, this is in Nehemiah. This is well after the Exodus. So for those that try to fit this captivity into the Exodus, it doesn't work. They were still to be scattered. And now if we go to Ezekiel chapter 5, we're going to see this still. We're going to get to, we're going to touch on Luke in a minute. So Ezekiel chapter 5, we're going to start at verse 7. All right. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, because ye multiply more than the nations that are round about you, and have not walked in my statutes, neither have kept my judgments, neither have done according to the judgments of the nations that are round about you. Therefore, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I am against thee, and will execute judgments in the midst of thee in the sight of the nations. So this is for all nations to see. This is why we're going through what we're going through. And I will do in thee that which I have not done, and whereunto I will not do any more the like because of all thine abominations. So he's like, I'm going to do it this time, and I'm never going to do anything like it again. So we know that there has this event that happens has to be significant. It means nothing like it has ever happened before, and nothing like it will ever happen again. And we know the transatlantic slave trade was unique in that nothing like it had ever been done before, where they took hundreds of millions of people and moved them from one continent to another continent and split up families and kept it going for hundreds of years. It says, therefore, the fathers shall eat the sons in the midst of thee, and the sons shall eat their fathers. Once again, that reference to cannibalism. And I will execute judgments in thee, and the whole remnant of thee will I scatter into all the winds. Wherefore, as I live, saith the Lord God, surely because thou hast defiled my sanctuary with all thy detestable things and with all thine abominations. Therefore will I also diminish thee. Neither shall my eye spare, neither will I have any pity. This is why these people have been able to do what they've done for 400 years, because this was a punishment from God. Thank you, moderators. I see you guys on the job. I didn't even see what was posted, but I see you guys in there blocking people. If they're being disruptive, put them in timeout. A third part of thee will die with the pestilence. Now, let me stop right here real quick, because you'll see people say that 2/3 of us won't make it. I disagree with that at this point. And here's why. I'm going to show you why in Ezekiel right here, because of these verses. I believe that part of this has already happened. It says a third part of thee shall die with the pestilence, and with the famine shall they be consumed in the midst of thee. And a third part shall fall by the sword round about thee. And I will scatter a third part into all the wind and will draw out a sword after them. So now the third part has been scattered. So you have these 2/3 that didn't make it, pestilence, famine, and the third part that fell by the sword. And then the 1/3 gets scattered. And then after them, he says, I will draw the sword after you. And we see what's been going on in the nations. So I believe that what we're seeing is the remnant of what's left of the full nation of Israel. And you see that they tell us we're only 13% of the population. But if you go back to some of the previous studies I did, I read sources that said at one point in the South, the slaves actually outnumbered the slave owners and the white people in the South. So what happened to all those people? They started lynchings and people started moving around the country and all that. But somehow we went from outnumbering them to only being 13%. So I believe that what we're seeing now, these however many millions of us there are, is the remnant. Because we also know that based on the documents that 80 to 100 million people died during the transatlantic slave trade, they estimate. So that's a lot of people. That's a crazy amount of population. I believe the United States only has what, 400 million. So that's like if a quarter of the population of the United States died off. All right. So let me keep reading. The third part of thee shall die with pestilence, and with famine shall they be consumed in the midst of thee. And a third part shall fall by the sword round about thee. And I will scatter a third part into all the winds and will draw out a sword after them. Thus shall my anger be accomplished, and I will cause my fury to rest upon them, and I will be comforted. And they shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken it in my zeal when I have accomplished my fury in them. Moreover, I will make thee waste and a reproach among the nations that are round about thee in the sight of all that pass by. All we have to do is look at how we're treated. We are a reproach among the nations, a byword. We know that no other people on the planet has a word meant for them like we do, the N-word. We know the N-word is meant for us no matter where we go. And in every language, it may sound different, but we know the word means black. We know that word means black. Whether they call us Swartz, the N-word, Negro, any of the other colors you could think of that mean black, that's what we're called everywhere around the world. So it shall be a reproach and a taunt, an instruction and an astonishment unto the nations that are round about thee, when I shall execute judgments in thee, in anger and in fury and in serious rebukes. I, the Lord, have spoken it. When I shall send upon them the evil arrows of famine, which shall be for their destruction, and which I will send to destroy you, and I will increase the famine upon you and will break your staff of bread. So will I send upon you famine and evil beasts, and they shall bereave thee, and pestilence and blood shall pass through thee, and I will bring the sword upon thee. I, the Lord, have spoken it. So these are part of the curses or circumstances that us and our ancestors have endured for the last 400 years here in America. We got 711 people in the live. Please do me a favor and hit that thumbs up or that like button. All right. So where are we at? Ezekiel. So now let's talk about the time of Jacob's trouble. This is what we're leading into. We talked about leading captive into all nations. So let's go to Jeremiah chapter 30. Jeremiah got a lot of stuff in it. If y'all have never read the book of Jeremiah, you should definitely read that book. So Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 7, the time of Jacob's trouble. Teo, I believe, and I don't want to misrepresent them, I believe that they said that the time of Jacob's trouble, they believe, started during the Inquisition. And I'm inclined to agree based on some of the things that I've been reading about the Inquisition, and how people were just murdered and raped and lynched, and children were cut out of the women's stomachs, and infants were bashed against the walls. And Jeremiah writes in the book of Psalms, the forgot exactly which chapter, where it talks about happy shall they be who dash thy children against the stones. Yeah, I went over that before. So I'm not going to go to, I'm not going to go over that now. Right here, I think this is an interesting, because it seems to point to the second coming. So we'll start from verse one and we'll go through verse eight. All right, so we'll go 1-8. Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 1-8. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord, saying, thus speaketh the Lord God of Israel, saying, write thee all these words that I have spoken unto thee in a book. For lo, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will bring again the captivity of my people Israel and Judah, saith the Lord, and I will cause them to return to the land that I gave to their fathers, and they shall possess it. So again, prophetically, he's going to bring the captivity, his people, out of slavery to back to the land to possess it. Again, this is in Jeremiah. And these are the words the Lord spake concerning Israel and concerning Judah. For thus saith the Lord, we have heard the voice of trembling, of fear, and not of peace. We know what's going on down here, and we know what we're all praying for. We know that our people want this to come to an end quickly. Ask ye now and see whether a man doth travail with child. Wherefore do I see every man with his hands on his loins as a woman in travail, and all faces are turned into paleness. Now, some people will use that and say, well, that means they were white, because only white people can turn pale. That's not the way the speech is being used there. It's not talking about why are all faces literally turning white. Because notice they said they see every man with his hands on his loins. So we know that Israel ain't in Africa being pale white. It just doesn't make sense. So you can't even use it in that context. It says, alas, for that day is great, so that none is like it. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble, but he shall be saved out of it. See, a lot of them are scared of the saved out of it part, because they know what comes with that. What happens in Genesis? We said that there's judgment. There's the 400 years of captivity, and then the nation is judged, and then they come out with great wealth. The judgment lasts a certain period of time. We just don't know the complete period of time that judgment lasts. We know Eurocentric Christianity teaches 7 years of judgment. However, when we go back and look, that may not necessarily be the case. That may just be the last 7 years, if that part is even true. So we'll touch on that more in a later study. It says, for it shall come to pass in that day, saith the Lord of hosts, that I will break his yoke from off thy neck, and I will burst thy bonds, and strangers shall no more serve themselves of him. Remember, they were talking about serving people they did not know in a land that they did not know, which is why Jeremiah says strangers shall no more serve themselves of Israel. But they shall serve the Lord their God, and David their king, whom I will raise up unto them. Let me see how far I'm supposed to go on here so I don't go too far. All right, yeah, we'll stop there. Oh, you know what? Let's go right here. This is actually perfect. Therefore, fear thou not, O my servant Jacob, saith the Lord, neither be dismayed, O Israel. For lo, I will save thee from afar. So wherever they are far away from Israel, and thy seed from the land of their captivity. Who on the earth right now is still living in the land where their ancestors were carried captive? We know it's us and other people that are scattered around the world via the transatlantic slave trade in the islands and England and everywhere else. And Jacob shall return and shall be in rest and be quiet, and none shall make him afraid. Well, we know it's not the 1948 people, because they're constantly at war. They're constantly worried about. I remember when I was younger, the suicide bombings were a thing, and that bothered, you know, of course that bothers anybody. But I mean, that was a thing going on in Israel, was those suicide bombings. So clearly that is not the prophecy fulfilled of them returning. They were also not in the land of their captivity. We are in the land of our captivity. And so when we finally return, it's going to be at rest, quiet, and nobody's going to make us afraid. Not no cops pulling us over or anything else. It says, for I am with thee, saith the Lord, to save thee. Now, remember what it said in Genesis, they were going to be judged. Jeremiah is prophesying a coming judgment. It says, though I make a full end of all nations, whither I have scattered thee, yet will I not make a full end of thee, but I will correct thee in measure and will not leave thee altogether unpunished. So Israel's punishment is what they're going to go through for this last captivity. But the other nations are going to be destroyed because of what they've done. And see, that's why they don't want it to be us, because they know if we're the true people of the Bible, they know they're the guilty nations being referred to in the Bible. And they think that they can just do whatever to us and murder and kill and rape and destroy families and lie and cheat and, you know, do all this stuff to our community. And they think there's going to be no consequences because of their liberty in Christ. But we know better. They will be destroyed. For thus saith the Lord, thy bruise is incurable and thy wound is grievous. There is none to plead thy cause that thou mayest be bound up. Thou hast no healing medicines. And we're not going to get too far into that. So now the time of Jacob's trouble. And usually people who like to deflect how terrible and how unique the transatlantic slave trade was, they'll do so by saying, well, the Irish were slaves. And we know that's not true. They were indentured servants. They'll say that, well, everybody went into slavery. Well, everybody going into slavery doesn't matter. It only matters about the line of Shem, specifically Jacob or Israel going into slavery. Everybody else going into slavery is irrelevant to Bible prophecy in the context of this. These prophecies made, it concerns Israel. So that's the only slavery that matters. So we need to find a slavery that matches what we see in the Bible. Now, we know this is different. Give me a second here. We know this is a different slavery because of the brutality of slavery. I just want to make sure I don't skip over anything real quick before I play this Pastor Kelly video. Give me a second here to pull up the video. Oh, wait, that's not. Oh, there we go. Not sure why I put it in my other screen. But I'm going to show you the Pastor Kelly video. And before I show you the Pastor Kelly video, I do want to read this article from the Wall Street Journal. I almost forgot about that. I did almost miss that. All right. So let me show you the Wall Street Journal article. 739 people in the chat. Please hit the thumbs up. All right. All right. Wall Street Journal. An ancient practice transformed by the arrival of Europeans. Slavery existed in Africa long before Columbus, but the transatlantic slave trade turned it into a very different institution. So we know that the transatlantic slave trade was completely different from what we know to be indentured servitude going on in Africa. Right here says a woodcut from 1888 depicts a slave caravan in the Congo. And right here, you see this guy right here. Propped up with this sticker. I don't know how that worked. This is like a yoke, I guess. Okay, so this is a yoke around his neck, and this guy right here with the axe about to kill him. And you see these two guys with yokes, and you see the women, and the men have yokes around their neck. These women do not, but they do have their hands tied behind their back, the children and everything, right? And so these people are being led into the slave trade. And we know in the Congo that there were Black Jews from Portugal dropped off. So now this is from September 20th, 2019. It says, long before Christopher Columbus sailed to the New World, various forms of slavery flourished in Europe and Africa. But these old world practices differed in important ways from the type of slavery that developed in the Americas after the institution of the Atlantic slave trade in the 1500s. New World slavery was a racialized institution in which slaves were Black and the slave owners were white. In contrast, owners and slaves in the Old World were generally of the same race. Distinctions between enslaved and freeborn people were often framed not in racial terms, but in terms of language, culture, and religion. The Greeks enslaved people whom they considered barbarians and both Christians and Muslims in the Middle Ages enslaved people whom they regarded as infidels. Slaves were seen above all as outsiders who lacked a social identity in their new community. All right. Excuse me. Servile institutions in Africa before 1500 were as varied as the political and social systems that enveloped them. Africa had large enterprises, powerful kingdoms, small chiefdoms, and decentralized political systems in which the highest authorities were the patriarchs of extended families. Social systems range from the rigidly stratified Mandi societies in the West African Sahel, which divided the population into hereditary categories of nobles, commoners, artisans, and slaves, to highly egalitarian societies that rejected the authority of chiefs and kings. Let me see here. Yeah, we're not going to be able to read the full thing, so I'll read till I can, because I don't have a subscription to the Wall Street Journal. In West African kingdoms, slaves of the king often lived in a separate agricultural villages and toiled to produce food for noble families and government officials, away from royal courts. However, enslaved people generally did the same agricultural and artisanal work as free people and dressed in a similar manner. Their role was to augment family and community labor rather than to replace it. In societies with decentralized political systems, slaves were dispersed instead of concentrated, lacking a standing army to pursue runaways or crush rebellions. The village patriarchs gave enslaved people incentives to remain loyal by promoting incorporation and economic mobility. So yeah, we'll stop right there. So Europeans coming into the slave trade completely changed how the slave trade or slavery, so to speak, was done in the New World. The Europeans were on another level of barbaric. As we talked about before, they were eating people. They were murdering people. They were raping people. They were beating people and lynching people and keeping body parts for souvenirs. I'm going to let Pastor Kelly explain some of this. Let me cue up the video because I think this is good stuff here. And in the video, he's going to talk about the time of Odin, and he's going to talk about, the time of Odin. And I think this is really good what he did. And we're going to listen to this about 2 to 3 minutes long. And he's going to talk about some of the brutality of slavery. And this is why I said some of this stuff about the land eating them up and the land of their enemies eating them up is going to be, I think, might be literal. So we got 760 people in the chat. Please hit the thumbs up and please share this. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen now. So you guys can go ahead and watch this video. Give me a second here.
Be not defiled, which Yahweh Elohim, yours will say Lord God, but Yahweh Elohim giveth thee for an inheritance. But what does it say again? His body shall not remain all night upon the tree, but thou shalt in any wise bury him that day, for he that is hanged is accursed. So guess what? The beginning of sorrows is actually the time of Odin. The time of the Gentiles is actually the time of Odin. The transatlantic slave war, I don't like to say trade, slave war, as well as the Arabic slave war, is actually the time of Odin. The lynching period is clear. The lynching period, because the Hebrew was not just crucified, he was lynched. The disciples, they were lynched. The people of the Most High were lynched. The defeat of the sacking, the siege of Jerusalem, they were lynched. So the lynching period is actually the time of Odin. Look at this here. I want y'all to pay attention to this. For those that keep hanging up these trees, our own brothers and sisters that don't have a clue about history, shouldn't even be teaching the word when you teaching about putting up a Christmas tree and you proud about it. Something is wrong with you. Actually, you're delusional. Remember, from the Tanakh, it says the laws of the nations are delusional. Look at what it says here. Look what you see in these images on your screen. To the left, hung all night, right? Look at this. Bounty for $200, $2 a dozen for inward ears. Look at this right here. What other community had to deal with what we had to deal with? We still being lynched right now. Being gunned down in the streets. That's part of the lynching process. On record, they recorded over 6,000, close to 7,000 lynchings, but that was far more lynchings. Tens of millions of our ancestors that was kidnapped. That's part of the lynching process. And many want to brag about putting up a tree. Could have easily debated these guys on this right here. But I didn't want to embarrass them by bringing all of this stuff up and showing them that they don't know history. They don't know research. Because if they truly research, guess what? The Holy Spirit would have led them to the, what I'm sharing with you guys tonight. Tens of millions of our ancestors. See, lynching is part of the torture. It's the process. That's why I want y'all to see these images here. This is the time of Odin. Remember, Odin was what? Said that he hanged humans on a tree to what? Use their drama to pay homage to Odin. Each victim's drama, recapitulated the death, rebirth of Odin himself. So when you understand the lynchings of our ancestors, those were satanic rituals that was taking place. Let me prove it here. What group of people have the history of fearing to be hanged on a tree? What group of people? It happened to the Israelites during the time of Nero and all those guys. They were fearing being hung on trees and, or should I say stakes and all those different things. What group of people still dealing with this now? You still got lynchings happening right now. They just passed a federal law a year ago saying that they're doing away with lynching. What group of people? Somebody tell me, what group of people? Those up there in the church? And yet we got Vocab Malone and the urban apologists trying to defend him when he say, let's do a parody of slavery in the USA. And then he using the term coon. Don't have a clue about history, Mr. Researcher. Don't have a clue about history, because if you understood the word coon, the word.
All right, Pastor Kelly starts to cut out and break up right there. I do want to show another part of Pastor Kelly's video as well, because he goes through, and let me make sure I cue that up right. Let me see. I just want to make sure. There we go. All right. Okay. So he starts to break up. Let me fast forward it a little bit. Now I'm going to share my screen with you guys again so you guys can see the rest of this. Now it does get graphic, not visually graphic, but description wise, it's going to get kind of graphic. But again, it's part of the curses. And we know this is unique because it's never happened to any other people before. On this scale, like it has happened to us and our ancestors. We got 756 people in the chat. I believe that's the most we've ever had in this particular chat. Make sure you guys hit that thumbs up and hit the subscribe button if you're not already subscribed. So I went forward just a little bit, and we're going to watch the rest of this, what Pastor Kelly has to say. Not the rest of it, because this is like another 40-some minutes, but just a couple minutes of it. Can you guys hear that? I just want to make sure you guys hear that before I continue. Let me I'm gonna make sure I hit the. Let me know if you guys can hear that. Press one if you guys can hear that, and then I'll start it again. I know you guys are on a slight delay from me, so it'll pause for a second, but I just want to make sure you guys hear it so I don't start playing it and then have to start all the way over. Mm-hmm. So hit that one if you guys could hear that. All right, I'm waiting to see ones now. All right, hit the one in the chat if you guys get. Okay, cool. See the ones now, finally. All right, there we go. I'm gonna start it. All right, I'm seeing mixed ones and twos. All right, let me stop it. And let me, hold on, re-cue the video. And then I'll do it again. All right, let me re-cue it real quick. And all right, I'll share my screen again this time. I'll make sure to click the share audio tab. All right, let me try this one more time. Here we go.
People were lynched. The Israelites was and continue to be lynched. So let's deal with the etymology dictionary of lynch as we get ready to wrap this up. We're at the end here. It means inflict severe, but not deliberately fatal bodily punishment on someone without legal sanction. See, you know, many try to debate whether or not the Willie Lynch letter exists or not, whether it exists or not. But guess what? The principle is still there. Let's look at here. It says from earlier. Lynch Law, 1811, in reference to such activities, which was likely named after William Lynch, 1742 to 1820, of Pennsylvania, Virginia. All right, let's go further here. It says other sources trace the name to Charles Lynch, right, a Virginia magistrate, who fined and imprisoned Tories in his district, but the connection to him is less likely. All right. It goes on to say, originally, any sort of summary justice, but it says, done without authority of law for a crime or public offense. All right, but we're not going to stop there. Let's get to the details here. The narrowing of the meaning of to extra legal execution. Let me say that again. The narrowing of the meaning to extra legal execution by hanging is evident by the 1880s, and after 1893, lynching mostly meant killing who? Killings of who? Blacks by white mobs, especially in retaliation for alleged. Notice what they said, alleged, because they will make up their makeup lies saying that you know, one of our brothers had touched or looked the wrong way at a Caucasian woman, and they would use that to rally their troop, the mob, to stir up the mob to do what? Torture, lynch our brothers and sisters. So look what it says. Lynching mostly meant killings of blacks by white mobs, especially in retaliation for alleged sexual assault of white women. Now, let me share one last key as we shut this thing down. All right,
now heads up, these descriptions right here are going to get very graphic for those that don't want their kids to hear them. Make sure you either turn it down or you whatchamacallit, get them out of the room, however you want to do it. But yeah, this is about to get kind of graphic.
Let me share one more thing. And guys, hit the like buttons, subscribe to the channel, share this video. I'm serious. Share this video. If we have over 100 people watching right now, it's like what? I think it's about 140, close to 150, whatever. At least we should have at least 100 shares on this video. Share it on your YouTube channel. Share it on your Facebook channel. Get those likes up so that way we can spread the truth about this right here. All right? So let's deal with this. Article Kissing Me. Valley, in other words, Florida Gazette, April 28th, 1899, Sam Holt burned at stake. Then you have another article, Springfield, Massachusetts, Weekly Republican, April 28th, 1899, Negro burned alive in Florida, second Negro then hanged. Let me give you a little information here, and we can wrap this up here. Before the torch was applied to the pyre, the Negro was deprived of his ears, fingers, and genital parts of his body. He pleaded pitifully for his life while the mutilation was going on, but stood the ordeal of fire with surprising fortitude. Before the body was cool, it was cut into pieces. The bones were crushed into small bits, and even the tree upon which the wretched met his fate was torn up and disposed as what? Souvenirs. Even the tree, they're saying, even the tree that he was tortured on, they took that tree and sold pieces of that tree as souvenirs. Let me go deeper here. The Negro heart The Negro's heart, and if you understand satanic rituals, they always cut out the heart. And guess what? They ate the heart because that represents taking the soul of the person. But they literally, it says the Negro's heart was cut into several pieces, as was also his liver. Those unable to obtain the ghastly relics direct paid their more fortunate possessors extravagant sums for them. Small pieces of bones went for 25 cents, and a bit of the liver crisply cooked for, cooked sold for 10 cents. As soon as the Negro was seen to be dead, there was a tremendous struggle among the crowd. In other words, the frenzy began, and all of them began to what? Fight for souvenirs. Do you know that they, you know, you got chairs that have cushions filled with our ancestors' hairs. They got belts and shoes that's built from the skins of our brothers and sisters. We've been eaten. We've been all kinds of things that was happening to our people. The time of what? Odin. The time of what? Sorrow. The time of what? Makabai. Right? Bara. Makabai. Beginning of sorrow. And a bit of the liver crisply cooked sold for 10 cents. As soon as the Negro was seen to be dead, there was a tremendous struggle among the crowd, which had witnessed his tragic end, to secure the souvenirs. A rush was made for the stake, and those near the body were forced against it and had to fight for their freedom. Knives were quickly produced, and soon the body was dismembered. They all pulled out their knives to get a piece of his body to eat. Even the tree upon which the wretched met his fate was torn up and disposed as souvenirs. The conclusion of the drama that Sam Holt, as well as others of our ancestors, was his body cut into pieces and sold as souvenirs. So let me give you some more scripture confirmation here. Because the scripture tells us no servant is greater than his master. So whatever happened to the master is going to happen to the servant, right? Let's deal with this here. John 19, verse 23 and 24. Then the soldiers, when they had lynched, paying homage to their gods, their deities, lynched the Hebrew Israelite Messiah, took his garments and made four parts to every soldier, a part, and also his coat. Now the coat was without seam, woven from the top throughout. They said therefore among themselves, let us not rend it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, that the scriptures might be fulfilled, which saith, they parted my raiment among them, and for my vesture they did cast lots. These things therefore the soldiers did.
All right, so the time of Jacob's trouble, we got 803 people in the chat. Make sure you hit the thumbs up button and make sure you subscribe. Make sure you share this video as well. The time of Jacob's trouble, nothing else like it. These people were engaging in cannibalism, mutilation, torture, rape. They did the most evil things, wearing people's skin as belts, and as Pastor Kelly mentioned, having using their hair and cushions. Let me go ahead and give you guys the link to that so you guys can go watch that on your own later. That's on Pastor Kelly's channel, We Woke Now. I'm putting a link in the chat right now for everybody. Pastor Kelly's channel is We Woke Now. Make sure you guys check out that video later on. So yeah, the time of Jacob's trouble. Nothing like this has ever occurred to any other group of people on the planet for this extended of a length of time, based solely on skin color, which we read in the Wall Street Journal. So now, why do we think judgment has to happen to the people that did this? Well, several reasons. Let me see here. want to make sure I got the verse right here in Peter. I believe it's Peter. Let me make sure. Yeah, it's going to be in Peter. Let me pull it up. Give me a second here real quick. All right. So now, I'm sorry, Ezekiel. I don't know why I'm saying Peter, but Ezekiel. So we're going to talk about Ezekiel. But anyway, yeah, a lot of stuff that they did was barbaric. And the time of Jacob's trouble is going to start the judgment. Judgment is going to start at the house of God. We learned this in the book of Ezekiel. And we're going to go to Ezekiel chapter 9, verse 4. Give me a second here. Hold on, give me one second. Let me open that one up and Ezekiel 9. Had to open up two things here. All right, so we'll start with Ezekiel and then we're going to move into Peter. So Ezekiel chapter 9, verse 4. Let me share my screen here with you guys. Yeah, that was rough for you guys, you know, listening to that. That was like the first time. I wasn't really surprised when I heard it because I was familiar with it. But man, it's just it's crazy that these people can do that and still think that they're going to just get away with it because of grace. I remember our ancestors had a covenant with the Most High and he did that to us and our ancestors. And they think that they're just going to get to skate by with no punishment after all the evil that they've done intentionally to God's people. It wasn't like it was an accident. Let me start at verse 1, the vision of slaughter. And this is going to be important because judgment is going to start with the house of God, which is we see the 400 years as a judgment placed on Israel because of them worshiping other gods and not following the Most High and his laws and statutes and commandments. And then after Israel's judgment ends, the 400 year judgment on Israel, then the nation that enslaved them is going to be judged. So the judgment is going to be an ongoing thing, which is why I talk about what we were learned in Eurocentric Christianity might not be exactly what it is. Thank you, Sarah. Super chat. Appreciate you. So, yeah, we have a 400 year judgment on Israel that carries out. And then after Israel's 400 year judgment, the nations that enslaved Israel starts the judgment. So judgment may last a lot longer than that 7-year period that we were told to believe. Judgment seems to last at least 400 and more or more years overall over everybody, Israel and the nations. Now, how long that's going to last, I'm not sure. So let me start reading Ezekiel 9, verse 1, and we're going to go to verse, 4. He cried also in my ears with a loud voice, saying, cause them that have charge over the city to draw near, even every man with his destroying weapon in his hand. And behold, 6 men came from the way of the higher gate, which lieth toward the north, and every man a slaughter weapon in his hand. And one man among them was clothed with linen, with a writer's inkhorn by his side, and they went in and stood beside the brazen altar. And the glory of the God of Israel was gone up from the cherub whereupon he was to the threshold of the house. And he called to the man clothed with linen, which had the writer's inkhorn by his side. And the Lord said unto him, go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. And to the others, he said in mine hearing, go ye after him through the city and smite. Let not your eye spare, neither have ye pity. Slay utterly old and young, both maids and little children and women, but come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. Then they begin at the ancient men which were before the house. So they started at the sanctuary to cleanse Israel after they marked people. Now we'll see this imagery in the book of Revelation as well, where the mark is set upon the 144,000. And then you see some judgment stuff begin. Now, this is Ezekiel, so we're going to go to Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 26 through 31. And we're going to see this here, judgment starts at the house of Israel. Oh, you know what? Let me go to 1 Peter first before we go there. So now in the New Testament, we see this. Yet if any man, well, let me go back up here. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 14, and we're going to go through verse 17. If ye be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye, for the spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. On their part, he is evil spoken of, but on your part, he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer or as a thief or as an evildoer or as a busybody in other men's matters. We've seen this happening when Eric Mason and Brother Tanzimore had their problem and Vocab wanted to insert himself as a busybody in other men's matters. And Brother Muhammad kept telling them, look, I'm not going to talk to you about it. And they do that. You'll find that the UA community, they often try to get in other people's business. It says, yet if any man suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God on his behalf. Thank you, Karen, and Super Chat. Appreciate you. For the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall the end of them that what shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God? And I find it interesting that this is a reference back to Ezekiel, because judgment in Ezekiel began at the house of God. He said, started my sanctuary. So now Peter is talking about judgment beginning at the house of God. And we're going to see after this, shortly after this was written, that the temple was destroyed and Israel was scattered. And then you're going to start down this period, which is going to lead into the 400 year captivity after they are scattered. So let's see here. Deuteronomy 4, we'll go through. Let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 4 now. Oh, wait. Type right now. Deuteronomy 4. All right, and we're going to start at verse 26. Thank you, Apostle, in the Super Chat. Appreciate you. Deuteronomy 4:26. All right, here we go. Let's go back up since there's a semicolon there. We'll start at verse 24. It says, for the Lord thy God is a consuming fire, even a jealous God. When thou shalt beget children and children's children, and ye shall have remained long in the land, and shall corrupt yourselves and make a graven image or the likeness of anything, and shall do evil in the sight of God to provoke him to anger, I call heaven and earth to witness against you this day that ye shall soon utterly perish from off the land whereunto ye go over Jordan to possess it. Ye shall not prolong your days upon it, but shall be utterly destroyed. And the Lord shall scatter you among the nations, and you shall be left few in number among the heathen, whether the Lord shall lead you, which I just mentioned that before. Thank you, Kendrick, in the Super Chat. Let me see. And there ye shall serve gods, the work of men's hands, wood and stone, which neither ye nor your father, which neither see nor hear nor eat nor smell. So they're going to serve other gods. We're going to serve other gods, wood and stone. So this comes up several times. And we've talked about some of the pagan traditions within what is called the Christian church. These pagan traditions that have been passed down to us. It says, but if from thence thou shalt seek the Lord thy God. Or if you from there, where you're going to be among these other nations, if you seek the Lord thy God, thou shalt find him if thou seek them with thy whole heart and with all thy soul. When thou art in tribulation and all these things are come upon thee, even in the latter days. Let me take a sip of water. Even in the latter days or the last days, if thou turn unto the Lord thy God and shall be obedient unto his voice, for the Lord thy God is a merciful God. He will not forsake thee, neither destroy thee, nor forget the covenant of thy fathers, which he sware unto them. Thank you. I think that's Rich Allen in Super Chat. Appreciate you. We're going to be saved out of Jacob's trouble. He says that if we will seek him, we will find him when we seek him with our whole heart. And it says, when we're in tribulation and all these things are come upon thee in the latter days, if we turn to the Lord, Lord our God, and be obedient, he will not forsake us. And I think this is the problem with some of them, why they don't like us following the law. Because understand, with spiritual warfare, remember, Satan is about self-preservation. The enemy is about self-preservation. So first he gives us a counterfeit belief system that looks like it could be the real thing. And then we come out of that, and then there are other doctrines within the Israelite community that we have to look at. Okay, they're Israelite Mormons, atheists, Muslims, all that stuff. We know this. And we have to look at those doctrines. And we say, okay, now that we understand who we are as a people, because that's our underlying belief, is that we are Israel. That is really the only thing that we have in common, just like any other group of people that Japanese believe they're Japanese. They're all together on that, you know, thing. But they don't all have the same belief system when it comes to, we'll say, religion, for lack of a better word. They don't all have the belief system. So now there's that level of it. And then once we hit that level, thank you, Diana, in Super Chat. Once we hit that part, then there is a dispute of whether or not we should follow the law or we should continue to use our liberty in Christ to do whatever we want to, like celebrate Christmas or engage in Easter or, you know, do some of these other things that the other people do. And that's a huge rift right there. But I think part of that is that the enemy doesn't want us turning back to God as full as we should, because he's trying to prolong his time. This is why he's mad with the woman. We wake up, and then after we wake up, we pray, and the Most High kicks off the whole thing, kicks off the final judgment. All right, let me see. Let's go to Deuteronomy 32. Let me speed this up a little. Let me share my screen again. All right, Deuteronomy 32. And we're going to go to verse 16. We're going to start at verse 16 and go through 27. Let's see. They provoked him to jealousy with strange gods. With abominations provoked they him to anger. Now, notice this keeps coming up. This is why I'm personally against the Christmas tree and Easter and all that other stuff. Don't even mess with it if it appears to be something that was part of the pagan problem. They sacrificed unto devils, not to gods whom they knew not, to new gods that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not. Of the rock that begat thee, thou art unmindful and has forgotten the God that formed thee, forgotten God that formed thee. And when the Lord saw it, he abhorred them because of the provoking of his sons and of his daughters. And he said, I will hide my face from them, and I will see what their end shall be, for they are a very forward generation, children in whom is no faith. Now, this comes up again and again. I've pointed this out before about God hiding his face until we seek him, until we diligently seek him. And that's why the prayers to end slavery were not answered. Even though people will try to twist that and say that I said that God didn't hear prayers for 400 years, that's not true. Is the prayers for slavery to end, God ignored those pleas for help. Thank you, Angie, in the super chat. We got 826 people in the chat. Wow. Make sure you guys hit that thumbs up button, please, and share this. And they moved me to jealousy with that which, let me see. Let me go back. And he said, I will hide my face from them, and I will see what their end shall be, for they are a very forward generation, children in whom is no faith. They have moved me to jealousy with that which is not God. They have provoked me to anger with their vanities, and I will move them to jealousy with those which are not a people, and I will provoke them to anger with a foolish nation. If you guys did not see that study that I did about angered by a stupid nation, go watch that. And it gives the breakdown in the Hebrew and the Greek. The actual word there used, it means stupid, not just foolish as in a nice way of saying it. It does mean stupid. And I show that in the Strong's. For the fire is kindled in my anger, it shall burn unto the lowest hell, and shall consume the earth with her increase, and set on fire the foundations of the mountains. And I will heap mischiefs upon them, and I will spend mine arrows upon them. And they shall be burnt with hunger, and devoured with burning heat, and with bitter destruction. I will also send the teeth of beast upon them, and the poison of the serpents of the dust, and the sword without and terror within shall destroy both the young man and the virgin, and the suckling also with the man of gray hairs. And I said, I would scatter them into corners. I would make the remembrance of them to cease from among men. Now, this is important right here because it talks about the memory ceasing from among men. And we're going to see that in Psalms 83, which we're not going to go through Psalms 83. We've gone through and touched on Psalms 83, the conspiracy, multinational conspiracy to make Israel forget their identity. We see this in Deuteronomy. We see it in Psalms. And I'm going to show you guys in a couple other places. It said, were it not that I feared the wrath of the enemy, lest their adversaries should behave themselves strangely, and lest they should say, our hand is high and the Lord hath not done all this. So he doesn't destroy them so that they can see that, okay, I'm in control. And this is what I want to happen. You can't wipe them out. Thank you, Leslie. And thank you, Joe's daughter. Appreciate you in the super chat. Now, make sure you guys hit that thumbs up, please. Let me read this last one. For they are a nation void of counsel, neither is there any understanding in them. Oh, that they were wise, that they understood this, that they would consider their latter end. So these are warnings. We know these warnings came long before it happened. Moses even reiterates that later on. And so now let's talk about the nation that did all this stuff to Israel, that scattered Israel. And wow, it's a lot of Bible verses here. Okay, so yeah, some of these verses I'm just going to give you guys as we go, because I don't want to keep you guys all day. Plus, I got a few things I got to do today, too. All right, so let's talk quickly about the nation that enslaved Israel. We're going to go to Joel chapter 3. Yeah, moderator, stay on it. I see you guys in there putting people in timeout. I see several people put the same person in timeout. All right. I don't know what he was doing or she was doing, but yeah, stay on that, please, and thank you. All right, Joel chapter 3. It talks about the regathering of the nations. I guess we'll start chapter 3, verse 1, because it'll lead into what I want to lead into anyway. For behold, in those days and at that time, in that time, when I shall bring again the captivity of Judah and Jerusalem, I will also gather all nations and will bring them down into the valley of Jehoshaphat. And I will plead with them there for my people and for my heritage, Israel, whom they have scattered among the nations and parted my land. Thank you, King Yosef. Appreciate it. And they have cast lots for my people and have given a boy for a harlot and sold a girl for wine that they might drink. Yea, and what have ye to do with me, O Tyre and Zidon and all the coast of Palestine? Will ye render me a recompense? And if ye recompense me, swiftly and speedily will I return your recompense upon your own head, because you have taken my silver and my gold and carried into your temples my goodly, pleasant things. This is going to be interesting because we're going to come across a verse that talks about Israel coming back from afar in ships. We see the verse in Deuteronomy 28:68 where they in ships, which is going to be interesting. It said, the children of Judah and Jerusalem, the children of Jerusalem, have you sold into the Grecians, that ye might remove them far from their border. Behold, I will raise them out of the place where you have sold them and will return your recompense upon your own head. I will sell your sons and your daughters into the hand of the children of Judah, and they shall sell them to the Sabians to a people far off, for the Lord has spoken it. And if you guys have not seen Teo Ministry study on the Sabians or the Sabians, make sure you go watch that. Now it says this, proclaim ye this among the Gentiles, prepare war, wake up the mighty men, let all the men of war draw near and let them come up. So the Gentiles are the ones that have done this. Let's see here. So yeah, you guys can read this whole thing. I'm not going to read this whole chapter. The Gentiles are going to be identified as the ones who did this. Now, we're going to go to Zechariah chapter 1:21, and I'm going to show you guys throughout the scriptures where it refers to the people. It's going to give us more and more detail as to the people that had to do with the involvement of Israel. So now we just have to look at slavery and say, okay, so who did what to who and who fits these descriptions? So people will say that, oh, well, every other people went into slavery. I covered that. So we have to find a circumstance under which people who are considered Gentiles enslaved people who are considered to be Israelites. And we can keep narrowing it down. If we go throughout the scripture, we'll go to verse 21. Verse verse 20. We'll start here. And the Lord showed me four carpenters. Zechariah chapter 1, verse 20 to 21. Then said I, what come these to do? And he spake, saying, these are the horns which have scattered Judah, so that no man did lift up his head. But these are come to fray them, to cast out the horns of the Gentiles, which lifted up their horn over the land of Judah to scatter it. So once again, the Gentiles are referenced in the scattering of Judah. This is part of the reason I do not believe it has anything to do with the Northern Kingdom in the New Testament. We have the Gentiles scattered Judah. And if you guys did not see the first five studies to this, please go back, or I guess technically the first, yeah, five or six studies to this, go back and watch those. So now let's go to Isaiah 18 and 1 real quick. You know what? Let's go to Deuteronomy 28:49 real quick. We'll go to verse 49. All right. Now, again, more details about the nation specifically that did this. The Lord shall bring a nation against thee from far, from the end of the earth, as swift as the eagle flieth, a nation whose tongue thou shalt not understand. So once again, we know that the captivity has to be from a nation that comes from afar. They can't understand the tongue of this nation, and they're going to move as swift as the eagle flieth. So we see that eagle reference right there, and I'm going to show you guys a few more eagle references to a nation. And so some of us believe that that refers to the United States, and some people believe it refers to Rome. Rome was not far from them. And as we see in the New Testament, Paul was a Roman citizen. There were other Israelite Roman citizens. They knew Latin. Paul knew Hebrew and Paul knew Greek. So Paul knew at least three languages. I don't know if he knew more or not, but this nation is going to come from afar, from the end of the earth, and they're going to move as swift as the eagle flieth. And a nation who has a tongue, they shall not understand. If you guys go back and watch that study I did on Deuteronomy 28, where they had to have other people who were enslaved translate the English language to assure the people being taken into slavery that they wouldn't be eaten by the Europeans. It says, a nation of fierce countenance, which shall not regard the person of the old, nor show favor to the young. We just watched the Pastor Kelly video. We see how they treated our people. We know about the gator bait stories where they would take the young and feed them or use them as bait to get alligators so that they could make shoes and belts and, you know, other stuff out of the alligator hide. So we see how these people have behaved. Let's go to Isaiah 18:1. It gives us another clue right there. I don't think any of this stuff is in here by coincidence. I think it's all, like I said, here a little, there a little. It says, woe to the land shadowing with wings, which is beyond the rivers or sea, or waters of Ethiopia, that sendeth ambassadors by sea, even in vessels of bulrushes upon the water, saying, go ye swift messengers to a nation scattered and peeled, to a nation terrible from their beginning hitherto, a nation meted out and trotted down, whose lands the river is spoiled. Now, they send ambassadors by sea. They're beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, and they send ambassadors by sea. So now, at one point, the whole continent was called Ethiopia, and then it gets smaller and then smaller till it gets over here in this little area. Thank you, contending for the faith in the super chat. All right. So now if they come across the sea, if they come from beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, the waters of Ethiopia by sea, they're going to come from beyond out this way, right? It just makes sense if they come from beyond Ethiopia. If you say they're coming from here, is a problem. Because we run into whatchamacallit down here and Antarctica down this way. So they're not going to come from down this way. They're going to come from over here. Now, some people could say they come from over here. But if you guys go back and watch the study I did, I talk about how it actually gives the direction of coming from the west in the verse. When you go to the Strong's, one of the words actually means west. So they come by sea. Who came by sea over here? We know the transatlantic slave trade map is going to show us. So let's go look at the transatlantic slave trade map. All right, so we see that the transatlantic slave trade, let me see if it'll let me make it bigger. All right, it's not gonna let me. I don't think it's gonna make me, let me make it bigger. Oh, that's weird. It won't even. All right, so we'll go back here. Let me close that down. So anyway, the slave trade happens over here, the transatlantic part of it. When they come in the ships, they start taking Israelites off the west coast of Africa, which many of us know from the research we've done. This one shows a little bit clearer right here. It shows how many people were taken or estimated people were taken. But yeah, they started going up and down the west coast of Africa, which was where the Portuguese had exiled the black Jews. And some people want to act like there's no way that that's connected to anything going on. They say, yeah, well, you guys are African. You guys are West African. Even though we know the Portuguese Jews were down there, there's no way possible that you guys could have been those people or descendants of those people. We read Cambridge. It says they were practicing Judaism and had a Torah, and yet they still don't put two and two together. Let's go to Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 6 through 12. Chapter. Oh, I did spell it right. Cool. All right. We're going to verse 6 through 12. For lo, I raise up the Chaldeans, that bitter and hasty nation, which shall march through the breadth of the land to possess the dwelling places that are not theirs. I think that's interesting. We know that the Gentiles are going to come from the ends of the earth and say their fathers have inherited lies. We've gone over the Japheth. Japheth shall dwell in the tents of Shem. And we're going to see these people called the Chaldeans. And the Chaldeans seem to be a race or people that are appropriators. I'm going to put this in a second to show you guys something. I can't think of the verse off the top of my head, so I'll do it in a second. To possess dwelling places that are not theirs, they are terrible and dreadful. Their judgment and their dignity shall proceed of themselves. Their horses also are swifter than leopards and are more fierce than the evening wolves. And their horses shall spread themselves, and their horsemen shall come from far. They shall fly as the eagle that hasteth to eat. They shall come all for violence. Their faces shall sup up as the east wind, and they shall gather the captivity as the sand. They shall scoff at the kings, and the princes shall be a scorn unto them, and they shall deride every stronghold, for they shall heap dust and take it. Then shall his mind change, and he shall pass over and offend, imputing his power unto his God. So now people will say that, okay, this stuff, a lot of this stuff has happened. It's been fulfilled. But again, history repeats itself. The thing that has been is the thing that shall be. So they come for violence. They gather up the captivity. And once again, we're gonna look at these Chaldeans, because like I said, they seem to be a nation of appropriators. I think it's singular in the part I'm looking for. Let me make sure. No, maybe it is plural. Go. Here it is right here. In Isaiah, that's what I was looking for. Behold, the land of the Chaldeans. This people was not till the Assyrian founded it for them that dwell in the wilderness. They set up the towers thereof. They raised up the palaces thereof, and he brought it to ruin. So we see, which is interesting, we see that the Chaldeans weren't even a people. The Assyrians, who come from Asher, who I believe are descended from Nimrod, if I'm not mistaken, they were Hamites. The Hamites had to build their civilization. So they went in and took over that. And then we see a prophecy that they will inhabit places that are not theirs. And so if we start to do some more research into the Chaldeans, we'll find some interesting stuff, but I don't want to get sidetracked with the Chaldeans right now. The Chaldeans are an interesting study. Now, I believe that some of this stuff is used to describe the people, not necessarily that they were descended from the Chaldeans, but I believe some of these things are interesting to point out that the Chaldeans are a nation full of appropriators who appropriated Hamite culture, who gathered up Israelites, and they start to dwell in houses that don't belong to them. They start to take things and live in places and live as a people that they are not. Let's go to Zephaniah 3:10. I'm going to give you guys some of these verses. I'm not going to go to all of these because I got a bunch of them. I got a few more that I want to cover. Zephaniah 3:10, from beyond the rivers of Ethiopia, my suppliants, even the daughter of my dispersed, shall bring my offering. So these other people come from beyond the rivers of Ethiopia to take his people. And then now in Zephaniah 3:10, we see that his people are coming back from beyond the rivers of Ethiopia. And let's go to Isaiah chapter 60, verse 9. Now, here's something interesting. Remember, in Joel, we read that they took his people into slavery and they took his gold and his silver. Here in Isaiah 60, verse 9, we find something interesting. Surely the isles shall wait for me and the ships of Tarshish first to bring thy sons from far, their silver and their gold with them, unto the name of the Lord thy God and to the Holy One of Israel, because he hath glorified thee. So the ships bring them back. Ships of Tarshish, bring thy sons from afar, their silver and their gold with them. So we see some compare and contrast here. Let's go to Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 11. I didn't realize I have so many Bible verses written down here. For I am with thee, saith the Lord, to save thee. Though I make a full end of all the nations whither I have scattered thee, yet will I not make a full end of thee, but I will correct thee in measure and will not leave thee altogether unpunished. We touched on that earlier, so I'm not going to go into that again, but just to show it to you. Thank you, Rising Moon, in the super chat. And we'll go to Jeremiah 46, 28. All right, 46:28. But fear not, we'll start 27. But fear not, O my servant Jacob, and be dismayed, O Israel. For behold, I will save thee from far off, and thy seed from the land of their captivity. And Jacob shall return and be in ease, and none shall make him afraid. Fear thou not, O Jacob, my servant, saith the Lord, for I am with thee. For I will make a full end of all the nations whither I have driven thee, but I will not make a full end of thee, but will correct thee in measure, yet I will not leave thee wholly unpunished. So once again, we see the same thing talked about one more time. All the nations are going to be punished for what they did to Israel. And for some reason, believers, I'll say that, people who call themselves believers seem to think that the European nations will escape unpunished after everything that they've done, them and their ancestors, because they have not made anything right. The descendants have not made anything right with what their ancestors did, returning people's land, paying reparations. They'll say, well, I didn't do it, so I don't owe anything. But you did receive stolen land and stolen money and businesses and benefits and all that stuff that happened because of your ancestors. So now let's talk about this second Exodus real quick. I want to move on because I've touched on a lot of this stuff before. The second Exodus is important. Because some people say, well, there's not going to be a second Exodus. And I showed you guys already, they talked about another captivity outside of the Egyptian captivity that had to take place in a land that's not their own. We see that prophesied by Jeremiah, people that they know not. Jeremiah 29, verse 14. And I will be found of you, saith the Lord. We just read this, but we'll go back here. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, saith the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. Then shall ye call upon me, and ye shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you, or listen to you. And ye shall seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. And I will be found of you, saith the Lord, and I will turn away your captivity, and I will gather you from all the nations and from all the places whither I have driven you, saith the Lord, and I will bring you again into the place whence I caused you to be carried away captive. So that second Exodus is there. It's hard not to bump into verses again multiple times with different subjects because it is what it is. I mean, it's a lot of information in the Bible. And I want to give you guys these verses. I'm not going to go through them all. We just read Joel 3. There's also Jeremiah 12, 14 through 17. Jeremiah 30, verse 3 and verses 10. Jeremiah 31, 8. Jeremiah 33, 23 through 26. Jeremiah 46, 27, and we'll go check. There's Malachi 3, 7, and then Ezekiel chapter 20. We'll go look at that real quick. Ezekiel 20. You guys can rewind this later and grab those verses and write them down or look them up. Ezekiel 20, we're going to go to verse 31. Make sure we didn't read this one already. If we read it, I'm not going to read it again. All right, right here. Wherefore, say, we'll start at verse 30. Wherefore, say unto the house of Israel, thus saith the Lord, are ye polluted after the manner of your fathers, and commit ye whoredom after their abominations? For when ye offer your gifts, when ye make your sons to pass through the fire, ye pollute yourselves with all your idols, even unto this day. And shall I be inquired of you, O house of Israel? As I live, saith the Lord, I will not be inquired of you. And that which cometh into your mind shall not be at all, that ye say, we will be as the heathen, as the families of the countries, to serve wood and stone. Now, this is important. It talks about the judgment of the people, the second Exodus. As I live, saith the Lord God, surely with a mighty hand and with a stretched out arm and with fury poured out, will I rule over you. I will bring you out from the people and will gather you out of the countries wherein ye are scattered, with a mighty hand and with a stretched out arm and with fury poured out. And I will bring you into the wilderness of the people, and there I will plead with you face to face. So once again, we hear judgment. Judgment is in connection with the second Exodus, judgment of the nations, a mighty hand, a stretched out arm, and fury poured out. That nation will he judge. He will destroy all the nations that scattered his people. They don't want that to happen. So for that not to happen, they need us not to wake up and to realize the truth. They need us not to turn back to God and to start following his ways. So now, the awakening. Let's touch on that real briefly, the awakening. Now, Psalms 83, we're not going to go through Psalms 83 because that's a whole study, but there's a multinational conspiracy to make Israel forget who they are. I've gone over this several times, which is why I'm not going to go over it again. This forgetting is also talked about throughout Scripture. It was an intentional effort to wipe out the memory of Israel. He said, I'll make the remembrance of them to cease from among men. Psalms 83, they are trying to figure out a way to wipe out their memory. So we're going to go to Romans 11. Let's go to Deuteronomy 28. Deuteronomy 28 and 28 real quick. And then I'll go to Romans 11. 28, verse 28. It says, the Lord shall smite thee with madness and blindness and astonishment of heart. Now, when I read that, I wondered, is that literal blindness or is that some kind of other blindness, like spiritual blindness as to who they were? I don't know. But I thought that was interesting right there. That they'll be smitten with madness and blindness and astonishment of heart. The madness is a mental thing. And we know mental health is talked about. It talks about sorrow of mind in through here. And it says astonishment of heart, being fearful, which is what made me question whether the blindness was a literal or a figurative blindness talked about. And I think it would probably be a figurative blindness, because then you would have to have a whole nation full of blind slaves. When Americans took our ancestors as slaves, and blind people aren't really as useful for doing the work that they were trying to have our ancestors do, or did have our ancestors do. Romans 11, 25. This is the other reason. I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, lest ye be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part has happened to Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. So Israel is partially blind, spiritual. This is spiritual blindness that Paul is talking about, until the fullness of the Gentiles be come in. And so it could be somebody said, why not both? It could be both. But I think in the context, it's probably referring to spiritual blindness. It says, and so all Israel shall be saved as it is written, there shall come out a Sion, the deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. So let's go to Ezekiel chapter 6. This blindness and Israel remembering is a huge part of end times prophecy. We'll go to verses 8 through 10. Yet will I leave a remnant, that ye may have some that shall escape the sword among the nations, when ye shall be scattered through the countries. And they that escape of you shall remember me, meaning they forgot, remember me among the nations whither they shall be carried captive. Because I am broken with their whorish heart, which hath departed from me, and with their eyes, which go whoring after their idols. And they shall load themselves for the evils which they have committed in all their abominations. And they shall know that I am the Lord, and that I have not said in vain that I would do this evil unto them. So this is a sign. And Deuteronomy tells us it's going to be a sign upon them and Israel and their descendants forever. And the whole reason is this for this is so that they will know and understand that we will know. I guess we would say our generation would know and understand what has happened. And we're starting to, a lot of us understand it. Unfortunately, many people who we, some of us considered or consider brothers and sisters in Christ, they don't want to understand, which makes me believe that we are, if we have not passed the fullness of the Gentiles, we are right upon that time. Let's go to Ezekiel chapter 11. And we're going to go to verse 14. And again, the word of the Lord came unto me saying, son of man, thy brethren, even thy brethren, the men of thy kindred and all the house of Israel, holy, excuse me, are they unto the inhabitants of Jerusalem have said, get you far from the Lord, unto us is this land given in possession. Therefore, thus saith the Lord, although I have cast them far off among the heathen, and although I have scattered them among the countries, yet will I be to them as a little sanctuary in the countries where they shall come. Therefore say, thus saith the Lord God, I will even gather you from the people and assemble you out of the countries wherein you have been scattered, and I will give you the land of Israel. And they shall come hither and shall take away all the detestable things thereof and all the abominations thereof from thence. And we know that there are abominations still going on in the land right now, like pride parades and atheism and racism and all that stuff that the 1948 people are doing over there. So clearly they don't fit the prophecy because all that stuff would be removed from the land. It says, I will give them one heart and I will put a new spirit within you, and I will take away the stony heart of flesh and will give them a heart, a stony heart out of their flesh, and will give them a heart of flesh, that they may walk in my statutes and keep mine ordinances and do them. And they shall be my people and I will be their God. So there is a return coming, and we're going to return back to the Most High. Zechariah chapter 10. We'll go there. All right, we got 824 people still in the chat. Go ahead and hit the thumbs up button, please. Zechariah 10, verse 9 through 10. And we're going to start wrapping this up. It says, and I will sow them among the people, and they shall remember me in far countries, and they shall live with their children and turn again. And I will bring them also out of the land of Egypt and gather them out of Assyria, and I will bring them into the land of Gilead and Lebanon, and place shall not be found for them. So again, we have this regathering talked about. And unfortunately, the church doesn't want to talk about the regathering. They don't want to talk about the awakening where we remember. The fact is, slavery, American slavery as they did it, matches everything. We were kidnapped or taken captive, put in ships, brought to a land not our own, a land of far, the far country, by a people whose language we didn't understand, a strange land. They erased the language. They changed the names. So if it fits the plot from Psalms 83. They even changed the name of the part of the Ethiopian Ocean to the Atlantic Ocean. They made us take on a new belief system. They made us get rid of all ancient beliefs. And then they assigned us an identity. They started calling us Black and Negro and African-American. They say we're sub-Saharan African, all of that. That's all Psalms 83. It fits prophecy. I will make the remembrance of them to cease from among men. What other nation of people has had their history wiped out like us so that we didn't forget or so that we didn't remember? And then when we start to look into who we are, what other nation or group of people faces so much opposition just for simply looking into our identity? Scripture, history, DNA, everything is always scrutinized because they want us to take the narrative that we were given. You're Black, you're Negro, you're African-American, you're sub-Saharan African. Everything except for Israel. We can be anything we want to be. Everything except for Israelite. But the more we start digging, the more we see that Israelite is the one thing we're not allowed to be. But Israelite is the one thing that keeps coming back up in the research, whether it be biblical, whether it be historical, or whether now the DNA. And now they want to say we're ungodly for looking at DNA. This is how they move the goalposts. It wasn't ungodly to look at DNA when all these Europeans were looking at DNA for all these years. We didn't hear that argument. It wasn't ungodly for Europeans to take jobs in the DNA field. But now that we're looking at DNA and it's showing things that they don't want to see, they are saying we're lying, we're making it up, we're using the tool wrong. They didn't call GEDmatch fraudulent, even though GEDmatch is a forensics company that works with law enforcement. See, they don't understand the implications of some of the stuff they say and how it may interfere in law enforcement cases. So a lot of that stuff that they've said, understand that GEDmatch is well aware of what Vocab is out here saying and Cherry is out here saying. They are well aware of what is being said. And they are potentially interfering in police cases when they make statements like GEDmatch is a fraudulent company, because that's not true. And we know it's not true. They just hate the results. Let's go to Jeremiah 31, and I'm going to start wrapping this up. Make sure you guys hit the like button. And if you haven't done so already, the thumbs up. Make sure you subscribe as well. 833 people in the chat. Yeah, definitely hit the thumbs up. Definitely share this. And we're going to go to verse 35 and through 37. Jeremiah 31, verse 35 to 37. Thus saith the Lord, which giveth the sun for a light by day, and the ordinances of the moon and of the stars for a light by night, which divideth the sea when the waves thereof roar. The Lord of hosts is his name. If those ordinances depart from before me, saith the Lord, then the seed of Israel also shall cease from being a nation before me forever. And we know that none of those things has happened, which means Israel is still a nation. Even though they would like to say that Israel is not a nation, they don't even agree. Many of the urban apologists disagree as to whether Israel is a nation and relevant to the end times or is not a nation relevant to the end times. But we know that Israel is relevant to the end times. Thus saith the Lord, if heaven above can be measured and the foundations of the earth searched out beneath, I will also cast off all the seed of Israel for all that they have done, saith the Lord. He's basically saying there is nothing that Israel can do to be cast off. This is why they don't want us to wake up. They want us to believe we're done away with. Hey, you guys, it doesn't matter that you're Israel. Don't look into it. Don't turn back to God. Don't start following the law. Don't call back Christ to bring judgment. I believe that many of them know what's in store once our people fully wake up and meet whatever requirements it is the Most High has set forth for us to call him back and bring judgment on these people. What we're witnessing, I believe, is we're witnessing judgment. We witnessed the 400 years come to an end, I believe. And now we're in the part where it says judgment. The nation shall be judged. So we're going to see judgment. However long that judgment lasts, we don't know. But after the nation is judged, we will come out with great substance. Again, we see people dropping dead. We see the lockdowns and people dropping dead all over the world, not just here in America, not just overseas, all over the world. Whether you believe COVID to be a virus, whether you believe it to be a biological weapon, it doesn't matter. People are dying. And so we see that happening, and we have never seen that before. We've never seen the whole world on lockdown before. We've never seen people released from prison because of a pandemic before. We've never seen 25% of the world covered in locusts and facing famine. This many people laid off from work. I'm not sure how many people were laid off from work during the Great Depression, but in our lifetime, we've never seen anything like this for sure. All at once, at the same time of people are waking up, people are asking for reparations. People are looking into our identity. And now we have access to DNA to confirm everything we already said. Because many of us, the journey didn't start at DNA. The journey started with the Bible. I personally awoke into the truth simply by reading scripture. And then when I started to look into the historical parts of it, that solidified it for me. The DNA, as many of you know, for me personally, DNA is recent. Just a few weeks ago, I started talking about DNA because I just got my results back a few weeks ago. So for those of you looking into your DNA, it's not ungodly to look at your DNA. That it makes no sense to say that looking at certain types of science is ungodly. In the past, they didn't have to have faith that they were Israel. They knew they were Israel because their identity wasn't erased. They knew who they were. They had their language. They had their customs. They had their culture. They had the Torah and everything else. So understand that watching the judgment, we're watching prophecy be fulfilled. We're watching the time of the Gentiles come to an end. And I don't believe the Gentiles are the Northern Kingdom. I believe the Gentiles are the European nations. If we look and see which nations or continents are controlled by European, we will see that a great majority of the world has European control or influence right now. And I believe they will come to an end. So anyway, I want to end right there. I might do a Q&A tomorrow, if not tomorrow, the next day for sure. So thank you guys for listening. We've been at it since what, 10 o'clock this morning, I think. So yeah, almost 4 hours. We've been at it. So I'm going to end it right there. My voice is getting dry. I do need some water. Thank you everybody in the super chat. Thank you everybody that tuned in. 842 people in the chat. Most ever. Please hit that 49. It just jumped up. Please hit the thumbs up button and please make sure you share this study. I appreciate you guys. And with that said, let me shut down the sharing thing. All right. With that said, till next time, I'm out.